Have you ever hit a wall, not physically, but mentally? Maybe you were finally getting into a good routine, building momentum at work, feeling optimistic about a new direction, and then something blindsides you. A relationship ends, a project collapses, a health scare pulls the rug out from under you. Suddenly, everything you were working on feels out of reach for you. You're stuck, unmotivated, and questioning whether you even have the energy to get back up. If this sounds familiar, you're not alone. And here's the important part. Setbacks don't mean you're weak or incapable. They mean you're human. More specifically, they mean your brain is doing exactly what it's wired to do when it experiences disappointment or disruption. I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and I help you strengthen your mind, fortify your brain, and build resilience. Today, we're kicking off a new module in this resilience series on how to bounce back from setbacks and reframe failure using brain-based strategies. In this first video, we'll talk about what happens in the brain when you experience a setback, why it can feel so destabilizing, and how to recover, not just emotionally, but neurologically. Your brain experiences a setback as a mismatch between expectation and reality, and that mismatch creates a dopamine crash. Dopamine is your brain's motivation chemical. It's heavily involved in anticipating rewards and driving goal-directed behavior. When you're working towards something, your dopamine levels rise as you visualize the outcome. But when a setback disrupts that outcome, especially if it's unexpected, dopamine drops. And that drop doesn't just affect motivation. It creates a kind of mental whiplash. You might feel flat, unmotivated, or like, what's the point? And that's not laziness or lack of willpower. That's your brain adjusting to the loss of expected reward. You're working against a temporarily disrupted motivation system. And the solution isn't just powering through. It's helping your brain find its rhythm again. And here's something else. Setbacks don't just sap your motivation. They also impair the very part of your brain that helps you figure out what to do next. The prefrontal cortex. And this is the region that handles planning, decision-making, and emotional regulation. Under stress, especially when the brain perceives a threat or failure, the prefrontal cortex becomes less active. That's why you might find yourself staring at your to-do list, unable to decide what to tackle, or why even small decisions may feel overwhelming. And at the same time, another area of the brain, the amygdala, becomes more active. And the amygdala is your brain's alarm system. When it senses danger or emotional distress, it kicks in to protect you. But it's not great at seeing nuance. It doesn't distinguish between I missed a deadline and I'm in real danger. So now you've got low dopamine, executive dysfunction, and a brain that's tagging your setback as a threat. No wonder it's hard to feel like you can move forward. And I want to add something important here. These brain changes can feel like depression for some people, but they aren't the same thing. Setback-related disruptions are typically acute and tied to a specific situation. Depression, on the other hand, involves long-term changes in brain function. But if you don't intervene, a prolonged setback has more significant consequences for you. So that's why it's so important to support your recovery early. So let's pause a minute to make an important distinction, because how you label your experience changes how your brain processes it. And there's a difference between a setback and a failure. A setback is usually something external. You got sick. Someone let you down. Life happened. A failure is more often interpreted as internal. I didn't try hard enough. I messed up. I'm the problem. But here's the thing. Your brain doesn't like uncertainty, so it fills in the gaps with a story. And too often, that story is, I failed because I'm not capable. And this kind of thinking can lead to what we call learned helplessness. A state where you stop trying because your brain has internalized the belief that effort doesn't make a difference. But most setbacks aren't about personal inadequacy. They're about disruption. Your nervous system lost its rhythm. Your executive system got overwhelmed. And now your brain is defaulting to protective mode. That's not failure. That's a stress response. When you're in this place, low energy, high emotion, another system in your brain takes over, the default mode network. This network becomes active when you're not focused on something intentional, like when you're daydreaming, ruminating, or replaying events in your mind. After a setback, the default mode network gets noisy. You start looping on questions like, why did this happen? What's wrong with me? And because the brain likes patterns, it pulls in past experiences to reinforce the current mood. You're not just reacting to what happened. You're reacting to every similar disappointment your brain can dig up. It's like an emotional echo chamber. And the longer you stay in it, the more real those distorted thoughts feel. This is where a lot of people get stuck. Not in the event itself, but in the narrative that builds around it. So what can you do to get out of the spiral? How do you reboot your motivation and re-engage your forward momentum? Let's talk about three tools that you can use to bounce back, tools that work with your brain and not against it. Number one, behavioral activation. Action first, motivation second. When you're stuck, the natural instinct is to wait until you feel motivated. But neuroscience tells us that motivation often follows action, not the other way around. Behavioral activation is a technique used in cognitive therapy to help people climb out of inertia by doing small, structured tasks that give you a sense of accomplishment. Even tiny wins can nudge your dopamine system back into gear. For example, sending one email, walking around the block, or organizing your desk. The action itself is less important than the fact that you're taking initiative. Have you ever gotten stuck with a dead car battery and needed someone to jumpstart it? That's how your prefrontal cortex can feel during a setback, like it's out of juice. These small actions are like jumper cables for your executive function. The second tool is using micro goals to avoid threat activation. When your brain is in a threat-sensitive state, big goals can feel overwhelming, even paralyzing. Micro goals are tiny, achievable steps that feel doable even when motivation is low. If your goal is to start exercising again, your micro goal may be putting on your workout clothes. And that's it. If you do more, great, but success is measured by starting. Micro goals help you build trust with yourself again. They say to your brain, see, we can still do these things. The third tool is to establish dopamine reset habits. After a setback, it's tempting to reach for quick dopamine hits like scrolling, snacking, or even zoning out. But those hits are short-lived and they don't restore long-term motivation. Instead, build in sustainable dopamine boosts like novelty. Try something new, even if it's something small. Or movement, even 5 minutes of walking or stretching. Connection. Call a friend. Social bonding is one of the strongest dopamine boosters that we have. And then completion. Do something that you can finish in one sitting. Even checking a box releases dopamine. These reset habits don't require a ton of energy, but they gently shift your internal chemistry just enough to help get you moving again. Once your brain starts to stabilize, the next step is to rebuild structure. And I want to be clear, structure isn't just about productivity. It's about giving your brain a rhythm that it can rely on. When your day has predictable anchors, like when you wake up, eat, move, or wind down, your brain conserves energy. You reduce the number of decisions that you have to make, which helps your brain stay calm and focused. But here's the catch. Don't use structure as a weapon. After a setback, you can respond with harsh self-talk, like, I need to get it together. No more excuses. But your brain doesn't respond well to threats, especially when it's already down. What it needs is compassionate accountability. And self-compassion isn't just a nice idea, it's neurologically necessary for recovery. Research shows that self-criticism activates the same threat systems we're already trying to calm down. But compassion activates your brain's caregiving system, which helps restore emotional balance and re-engage your prefrontal cortex. So when you notice yourself being impatient or harsh, try asking instead, what would support look like right now? Sometimes the answer is rest. Sometimes it's routine. Often it's both. So let's reframe how we think about setbacks. They're not signs of weakness or failure. They're signals. Your brain is asking for recalibration, not punishment. And the good news is your brain is adaptable. With small actions, consistent structure, and self-compassion, you can bounce back. In fact, you can often come back stronger than before. In the next video, we'll talk about how your brain actually learns from mistakes. Setbacks disrupt, but failure refines. We'll explore how your brain uses prediction error to grow smarter and more adaptable over time. Thanks for watching today. If this resonated with you, feel free to share your experiences in the comments. And don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss the next episode in this resilience series. I'll see you then.